hot cuppa and relax. It's Afternoon Karak with Aisha Al-Mazmi and Mikhail Atia
on Pulse 95.
Finally, Thursday. I am relieved, happy, and excited.
Oh my God. Oh my God.
What do you have?
I have no words to express the joy, the enthusiasm, the anticipation of this day coming to a close. I told you yesterday I got that new table, right?
Oh, you got it? You got it yesterday.
Yeah.
Did you clean it up? Is it ready to go for the weekend?
I unpacked it. I've prepared my bedroom. I'm gonna have to move a few things around.
Understandable.
But today I'm going to have a board game session with the guys, and I'm just so excited to use the table. So I'm just through the moon, to be honest.
Well, you should also be through the moon as well, because Green Knight is officially out in the UAE.
Oh my God.
The 19th of August. We've been waiting for this for so long.
It's a good time to be alive, and it's a good time for you tuning into the magic hour that is the Afternoon Karak.
Oh yes, certainly. Today we've got lots of things to talk about. Last week, because Thursday was off, we did not get the chance to talk about the first episode of Marvel's What If, but don't worry, we're back here. We're going to give you just a quick run through of episode one and then focus on episode two.
Yes, as well as we have a little, you know, interesting celebration to end the week off.
It's a good celebration. It's a really good celebration.
Yeah.
Again, we've spoken about it, but I feel like this thing in particular, you cannot ever stop celebrating it.
You're right. And also, we're going to be highlighting everything that was, announced at the Pokemon Presents. So tune in for Aisha. She's gonna give all the deets, as we say.
All the deets. It was quite long. It was around 28 minutes long. At the beginning, obviously, they're giving us a rundown of some other things that are ongoing, and then they jumped into the good things, like the juicy things. And I'm like, you know what? It is time for me to pay attention, because they did announce a lot of new things that were quite interesting, a new addition to all these Pokemon games. And this is just typical from Game Freak and the Pokemon Company, because they tend to introduce new mechanisms, weird mechanisms, in the other games and not in the main games. So I'm very excited to talk about this one in particular.
Can't wait. Also, yesterday we talked about Fortnite's imposter mode, but it seems that InnerSloth, the developers behind Among Us, had a few things to say, and it's a little bit upsetting. So guys, Marvel fans, Among Us fans, Pokemon fans, be sure to tune in and join in the conversation. Text us 4215 and select or do. Let's make your Thursday a little extra happier right here on the Afternoon Karak.
Is it an epic or epic failure? The Big Review. Movies, games, and TV in focus.
Pulse 95.
Following Loki, now we jump into Marvel's What If. So if you guys have not watched it, here is a clear warning that we're going to be going into spoiler territory. We did not get a chance to talk about the first episode last week, so we're going to go into that a little bit before jumping straight into episode two. Now, What If basically asks the question, what if some of the most prominent parts that have happened in the MCU were slightly different? For example, in the first episode, we had the amazing question of, what if Steve Rogers did not become Captain America, but rather Peggy Carter becomes Captain Carter?
Personally, when I watched this episode, I really was vouching. I was hoping that after I finished the episode, that Marvel would announce a spin-off series of Captain Britain or Captain Carter, because she is the better version of Captain Britain, in my opinion.
Listen, I've been saying this since day one, like such a long time ago, that we have been deprived. First of all, this Agent Carter, the show, was so good. It was part of Marvel's TV shows, like way before Marvel announced the MCU TV shows, like around Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and whatnot. And it was such an underrated show. We got, you know, Howard Stark, and we got, you know, Peggy Carter. Like, what happened to her? How did she create S.H.I.E.L.D.? Because after the war, what happened is that she was forced to basically do some really small jobs here and there, and she had basically lost her purpose, but she wants to bring it back. She just... becomes this amazing and great character, and I feel like we missed out on it when they basically retconned Peggy Carter, and well, in this series, Agent of Carter, basically Agent Carter, and they kind of gave us two seasons, and then they gave us a kind of a cliffhanger. They did not continue it, and they did not make it MCU canon. And then we kind of hear about her or see her a tiny bit within the MCU when she's older, and then she gets, you know, she dies basically. We don't ever see her again. So we miss out on an amazing character. But in this like 30 minute episode, we delve deep into that, even though it was quite brief. And what I love about these shows, I mean, this show in particular, is that interestingly enough, it covers what would be an entire movie in 30 minutes.
Yeah, I'm so surprised it can put so much in such a short amount of time. And you sense similar story beats if you've watched
exactly,
the movies.
Yes.
But it's not in a way that comes off as redundant. No, it's refreshing. It's like, oh my God, I remember that. Oh, that little quip, or they say something that makes me go back to the original movie, and how they change it around. You know, it has an alternate take. But still, in a way, it almost respects the original storylines.
Oh, very much so. I mean, the small nuances here and there in the first episode were so good. It was also very interesting to see, you know, a little bit, you know, more about how they took the story of Captain America, in the sense that we got the how, you know, how obviously Steve was frozen for 70 years, right?
Yeah.
Instead of having Peggy frozen for 70 years, something slightly different happened. And I really like that, the whole thing with the intergalactic, you know, creature, the octopus creature, and how Fury brings her to, you know, modern day America. That was very interesting. I really enjoyed that. Now we move on to the second episode of What If, and that is T'Challa. What if instead of Peter Quill, the Ravagers accidentally grabbed T'Challa instead?
And I'll be honest, this is, again, my I'm looking at this episode, I'm like, everything about this storyline works in tremendous ways. And what I love about it is that T'Challa works so well as a intergalactic, you know, adventurer, explorer, ravager.
Did you realize the way that they changed what the
completely
Star-Lord is? Because
yeah,
in the original Star-Lord, in the MCU, he is like this troublemaker. He's going around stealing things.
Nobody takes him seriously. He's a joke. But T'Challa is like the galactic Robin Hood.
Exactly.
People love him, you know? And
I really like that small change, because when I went into this episode, what I thought would be is like, it's going to be just, oh, T'Challa's going to be just like Peter Quill. He's problematic. He's going to cause trouble. It's going to be an interesting look into him. But rather, no, they took T'Challa's actual, I'd say, original personality as if somebody who, you know, seeks honor and is an honorable person, a hero, basically. And they just put him up in space. That's it.
I did find it maybe a little overbearing in the first part of the episode, but then they cemented it with Thanos.
Thanos
himself appearing.
Thanos.
I'm like, me and my friend, we were screaming. We're like, no way, what is Thanos doing?
The ongoing joke where every time he tries to explain his amazing grand plan, and everybody was like, yeah, that's genocide.
Oh my
that
God.
That is considered
so hilarious.
When they called him Captain Genocide. I love that. And the fact that Ronan's henchman, if you remember him from, you know, the previous movies.
The Collector.
Not the Collector. I'm talking about the henchman who eventually becomes part of the Ravagers team. I love that. That's just, again, small parts where you'd expect this person, like even in the actual movies, in Guardians of the Galaxy, this character in particular is very savage and he's angry. But here he's like, oh my God, it's Star-Lord. And he's fangirling the entire time throughout the entire episode. So it was very lighthearted, but it also dealt with a lot of heavy themes as well.
Yeah, my favorite part about the episode is the dynamic between Thanos and Nebula. It's just as complicated and interesting as the original storyline. And one interesting thing about the whole episode is that halfway through, it turns into an Ocean's 11, but in space.
Oh, yeah.
With, you know, a few twists and turns, like a third backstab of some kind. It's really cool.
Oh yeah, it was incredibly cool. Everything about that show took me at least by surprise. I did not expect myself to enjoy it this thoroughly. It's very lighthearted in the sense that, I mean, it just does not feel as heavy as the previous three shows. But at the same time, you have to also keep in mind that What If is still canon and makes you wonder, like, is it somehow, you know, something is gonna link up with the, you know, MCU canon somehow as well.
I wonder, but maybe the world that T'Challa's in this one, it might not exist very soon. And I think,
oh yeah, yeah, it's not
a little hint on that.
We said spoiler territory, but we're gonna leave the ending for you guys to watch.
The best part also is the fact that Chadwick Boseman is voicing the original T'Challa character, and even what's even better is that the executive producer Brad Winterbaum, who works on the show, says that we'll see a lot more Chadwick Boseman voiceovers in future episodes of the What If series.
This just is a lovely way of, you know, basically telling him goodbye, because again, it's such a lovely show and we enjoyed it. Again, I was taken by surprise and not expect me to enjoy it this much, but I certainly am. Look forward to the next upcoming episode next week. Stay tuned next Thursday for our next review of the third episode of What If. Before we wrap up, I have to say Jeffrey Wright as the Watcher. Beautiful. Mm-hmm. Just the narration was amazing. And again, I think the Watcher is the one who's going to be somehow canonically connected to future MCU movies. We have a celebration coming up. We're going to be talking a little bit more about What If and something to do with the voiceovers. We spoke about Dave Bautista and what was happening with him and Drax and the fact that he did not voice him in this episode. But now we move on to Peter Parker and what is happening with Tom Holland, because Bradbury himself says that he may have hinted as to why Tom Holland was not available for his episode. Coming up next, right here on the Afternoon Karak.
What's the date?
What's the date?
What's the date?
What are we celebrating today?
Happy Potato Day.
Happy Potato Day, however you'd like to call it. There's a scene from Lord of the Rings where Sam, he's with Gollum, and Gollum's like, what are you cooking? He's like, oh, it's potato. You know, it's the best thing ever.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And Gollum's like, nah, I wouldn't eat that. It's too dry. He'd rather eat raw fish. And just shows you Gollum's taste. But anyway, happy Potato Day.
It's a good day to celebrate.
I'll be honest,
it's a Thursday as well.
It is the most important starchy commodity of our lively diets. I cannot live without potatoes. I think there's not a day. Actually, no, that's too much. But maybe there's not a week I go without having potatoes in shape or form.
Definitely, whether it's French fries, tater tots, smiley fries, mashed potatoes, I don't know, potatoes and gravy. It's so versatile. And speaking about versatility, I came across this interesting way of cooking potatoes, and it's the 15-hour potato.
Why? What's that?
It's just incredibly crunchy. I mean, check it out on TikTok. Ooh. I came across this chef. She's in the UK. Her name is Poppy. And I love the way she tackles potatoes. She calls herself the potato chef. And through her, I was introduced to several ways of handling potatoes. But the most important one is a 15-hour potato. Even though I feel like I've seen other people on TikTok also tackle it and make it in a shorter amount of time. But I feel like the way she makes it is actually very simple despite the time span. And it is so good. I mean, I'm obviously just looking at it through the screen, but even then, you look at it and you're like, this looks incredibly good. I wish Poppy was here right now in my kitchen.
I've seen some videos on TikTok of people doing like this fry challenge where they get their air fryers and they try to make the best type of fries using just that device. And they make a little few tweaks, like adding, you know, maybe certain ingredients, putting the potatoes after they gets cooked for a bit into the fridge, bring it out, and do all these little techniques for a crispy, delicious type of potato.
Fun fact. So apparently an air fryer is just a convection oven, by the way.
I know.
Which is like you can just use an oven. Although no, don't get me wrong, guys. I am a big supporter of air fryers. They make your life much easier.
The thing is, I know that and I still want to get it.
I get you. Same here. I mean, I think we have like at least one air fryer or two that my mom bought. You know, back when it first came out and nobody knew much about it, maybe like 10 years ago, and it's somewhere in our kitchen. So I need to go dig it up and maybe try out some of these fry concoctions. Yesterday I had thrice fried potato chips. And they were, even though they were drenched in sauce, which, you know, usually when you have lots of sauce on fries, it becomes soggy. But not this one. This one was so crispy regardless.
Oh, my God.
And it was so, so good. Guys, tell us, how are you celebrating Potato Day? Tell us your favorite ways to eat potatoes, make potatoes as well. 4215 Ittisalat, or do fun fact that it's also very easy to grow potatoes as well. Have you attempted that? Tell us all about it. We're going to be talking one more time about what if, but rather what is happening with the voice acting thing, the whole, I say, controversy behind it, and what is happening with Tom Holland and why didn't he voice Spider-Man? Coming up next right here on the Afternoon Karak.
This is Pulse 95.
Last week, we were talking about how there was probably some sort of miscommunications, especially since Dave Bautista announced that he was not contacted to voice the character of Drax in What If? And the executive producer of What If, Brad Windenbaum, said that, no, actually, we did speak through every single actor and actress in the MCU or through their agents. So there must have been something happening. Now we move on to Tom Holland, another mystery, especially since at least Tom Holland is on good terms with the MCU, with Marvel Studios, with Disney. And he is going to be coming back, reprising his role as Spider-Man at least for two more times. So the question is, why didn't he come back and do the voice of Spider-Man? Now, according to executive producer Brad Windenbaum, he kind of gave a clearer statement about his absence. He says, you know, I'm not treated to all the ins and outs of the relationship with Sony, but I think it may have had something to do with it. That makes sense.
That is as clear as it can get, to be honest. I've said in the past that Sony is the thorn in Marvel and Disney's back, because they're clutching on to that Spider-Man intellectual property as much as they can, to the point that Marvel actually had to make a partnership deal to agree that they will in some way merge together when they make these MCU integrated movies. But I think why Tom Holland was not part of this is that deal itself only covers the cinematic films, not this animated series.
See, the thing is, I feel, or at least as far as I understand, or according to my predictions, is that this deal was probably written maybe before What If was announced, or was still in the works, like way beyond, in the sense that it was in the works as in it was still written, or people are still thinking about it. So maybe they did not include it in the clause, and Sony was like, it's not going to happen, not on our watch. You're not going to take him for this, even though it could have been easily amended. So it's kind of interesting that maybe Disney or Marvel were like, you know what, it's not worth it, we're not going to go into this anymore. Or maybe they did approach Sony, and Sony were like, nope, it's not going to happen. Again, this is just from Brad himself. He himself doesn't know much about it, even though I feel like he might know some things here and there. But it's just unfortunate that Sony and Disney have had this strange agreement. It is an understandable one, but, you know, I feel like it's for the fans. Do something for the fans, guys. Come on.
What If series is a fan service. It's a love letter to the fan base.
Absolutely.
And not having all the voice actors there feels like a mixed bag. So I hope maybe when season 2 does come out, that Marvel and Disney really go out of their way to bring original voice actors, despite whatever drama is behind the curtains.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Those are just some of the things we've been talking about. We're going to be talking about more stuff, guys, especially Pokemon Presents from yesterday. It was a very beefy presentation. We're going to be talking a little bit more about Marvel, because apparently, according to rumors, Anthony Mackie has signed up for a Captain America four, and the Among Us devs are not happy with Fortnite's new imposter mode. Coming up next right here on the Afternoon Karak.
This is Pulse 95.
A surprise showcase from Nintendo featuring none other than Pokemon. The Pokemon Presents has released tons of new trailers and information about some upcoming Pokemon projects. And we got Aisha here, the Pokemon connoisseur, to tell us all the details.
So, of course, they kicked it off with the games that are already out and available, such as Pokemon Unite that just came out. They just announced that it's going to be also available on mobile phones very, very soon, kind of expanding the game beyond, you know, the people who would rather play, instead of just having people play on the Nintendo Switch, people who don't have the Switch can now play on their phones very soon. So some news about Pokemon Go, etc. But then the most important part, I'm going to skip all of that because the second half of the, or at least the quarters of the Pokemon Present Direct was a lot more beefier and I'd say more important in comparison. No offense to all fans of Pokemon Go and Pokemon Unite. And that is Pokemon Diamond and Pearl. The remakes have been basically got a little bit of a glimpse into the world and a little bit about how they're going to be changing it up because it is a remake of the old game. So obviously they're going to take the big elements from the actual game and then going to change up a little small things here and there just to make the game a lot more immersive and more interesting.
Modernizing the classics.
Oh yeah, definitely. So obviously they kept the whole chibi kind of compact kind of feel of the game back when it was on the Nintendo DS, but then they added to the whole same elements that you will find similar in Pokemon Sword and Shield, such as having, you know, Pokemon roaming around, etc. And also the battle itself, it's all 3D and it's basically made or modernized, just like Mikhail said, for the Nintendo Switch. They've included some new things, such as, you know, changing your clothes. That is part of the newer Pokemon games, so it just adds an extra level of personalization. And also now you can, okay, the underground was an integral part of the Pokemon Pearl and Diamond series all the way a long time ago, but now in this version they added something extra where not only do you personalize your area and go down and battle people, but rather if you personalize it or decorate the area in a specific way, you can trigger the appearance of certain Pokemon, and some of them are only available in the underground. So again, another level of competitiveness, a level of difficulty, just beyond just roaming around in the game and trying to quote-unquote catch them all.
Gotta be the best, as they
say. Oh yeah, definitely gotta be the best. And then the next one, the big part, the beefiest one and the one that got me really excited, and I think a lot of people got really excited, is Legend of Arceus, because this is not part of the main game at all. It's one of those side games, and if you guys remember, I've said this before, that this is where Game Freak and the Pokemon Company just kind of goes crazy with their concept. And one of the biggest thing that they changed is the way you fight and your role. You don't go around and roam around and just, you know, go ahead and raise Pokemon and catch Pokemon and go to gyms and whatnot, because this is centered in the old version of the Sinnoh region, because Sinnoh is the version that is, or the region that is in Diamond and Pearl. But this is, let's say, around 1800, 700 Japan-inspired sort of era. And that's why it is called the Hisui region instead. It's a different name. And also, what I love about it is that they brought back the whole regional differences, because obviously it's been, let's say, 300, 400 years, or at least 300, 200 years since the main games. So it's like, how did the Pokemon look like back then? Did they all look the same? Not really. So they introduced some new versions of Pokemon. Everybody's going crazy about the Hisuian version of Growlithe. It's like, he's so adorable and cute. And it's also inspired by some of the, I say East Asian or Japanese / Chinese, mythology. He looks adorable and I cannot wait to have him. And what is interesting is also for the first time ever since, you're not only trying to catch the Pokemon and learn about them, Pokemon can actually beat you up as a person, as if they can attack you as a human.
A much necessary evolution in the franchise.
And because they're saying that you're basically trying to learn about them. You don't have the mechanisms and the education and the gadgets you used to have in the future. You do have sort of a prototype Pokeball, and that's exactly what you're doing. You're going around and you're trying to catch those Pokemon, but at the same time, you're in danger. They can come up and they can, can basically make you faint. I'm not going to say kill you, because you don't really die in the Pokemon games. It's for kids.
Not yet, at least.
Do you remember that MMORPG Pokemon game? The one with the guns?
Oh my god.
That one, you can probably die there, but you cannot die in any of the actual Pokemon games. So again, adds a new different level, an added level. And also, even though you do have your own Pokemon to sometimes fight, there is two types of them. I mean, there is two styles. There is a strong style fighting and agile for a type of fighting. I'm not going to go much into details. I'm going to bore you guys. So guys, check out that video. So many things are happening in that. It's just the last part, the last 15, 20 minutes. And it's so good. It's a, I wouldn't say a necessary, much needed thing, because this is just part of the whole Pokemon plan. You've got the main games that sort of stick to a certain plot line. They do add some things, they add some new experiences, but then it is those side games that are much more richer. Even though, honestly, I love the main games, don't get me wrong, I'm a big, big defender of the main games, and I love the fact that they stick to a certain
almost like standard.
Oh yeah, definitely. But then the fact that they have the ability to just go crazy in the side games.
Experiment all that.
Exactly. Especially now, this is, they took all these big elements from Sword and Shield and they just went crazy with it. There it has even elements of Pokemon Snap. It is so much fun. Cannot wait for it. And they also announced some new versions of the Pokemon, the Nintendo Switch that were created for the new remake of Diamond and Pearl. And those are just a little bit, I mean, it's a glimpse, an introduction into what to expect out of Pokemon's new upcoming games. The first one is coming out, the Pokemon Diamond and Pearl, coming out a little bit later in the year, around November, and then Pokemon Legend of Arceus coming out next year around spring. We're going to be taking a short break, and coming up next, we're going to be talking about a little bit more about Marvel. We're sorry, it's a Marvel-filled hour today. We're going to be talking about how potentially Anthony Mackie has officially signed up to become the none other than Captain America in the upcoming Captain America 4, coming up next right here on the Afternoon Cut-Up.
Speculation. Gossip or hoax? Rumor has it.
Okay, this seems that it's very obvious that you might be going like, Aisha, why are you guys using the rumor has it then? Like, why are you saying it's a rumor? The reason why we say it's a rumor, because this news comes from Deadline, and they don't say who their sources are. They just say sources say that Anthony Mackie has closed a deal to carry the shield in his first superhero picture in Captain America 4.
That is some exciting news. Mm-hmm. And even though right now it's just a rumor, it's an obvious, almost like an obvious announcement or something that will eventually happen.
Oh yeah, it's expected.
The series was setting it up from the beginning, Falcon Winter Soldier, and Anthony Mackie stepping in to take that shield is definitely going to be a whole new refreshing take on the superhero story arc that is Captain America. I feel like for this phase that we're in, phase 4, a lot of it is just building up to the bigger films like the Avengers and Captain America and those other standalone superhero movies.
Yes.
So for now, this is just an exciting news, but one that I need to kind of manage my expectations for.
Oh yeah, definitely. The thing is, the importance of this announcement says, or at least indicates, that at least something is happening, something is moving, which means we're going to be getting Captain America 4 sooner than we originally thought. I knew that it's going to be coming around within the next maybe 2 or 3 years, but perhaps the fact that it's, you know, there, he has officially signed up, it means that the script has been written, or at least is in the process of being written. They're probably scouting, or at least already have a director, and the crew is getting, you know, getting more solidified as we get closer to the date and the announcement. Exciting news all around for Marvel fans. We are very happy. We've been fed very well in the past couple of months, alhamdulillah, after a whole year of drought. I mean, I know it was due to unforeseen circumstances, unfortunate circumstances, but at least we're going to be getting a lot more news and interesting things in the upcoming months, especially since Shang-Chi just premiered yesterday, or before yesterday, in the United States. I mean, the special premiere. And we're going to be getting it very, very soon in September, right here in the UAE. Now we move on to some sad-ish news as we talk about the Among Us devs kind of showing their dismay and their disapproval of Fortnite's new imposter mode coming up next, right here on the Magic Hour, the Afternoon Cut-Up.
You're listening to Pulse 95.
Epic Games, the developers of Fortnite, just recently released a Fortnite Imposters mode. Something similar to Among Us, taking a lot of inspiration from general mechanics and map designs and all that. But how much of it, how much of those similarities, how much of those inspirations are just plain copying? And the creators of Among Us, Inner Sloth Studios, have you know, shared their opinions on Twitter, and to our surprise, actually, they were kind of not happy that Epic has copied their game so blatantly, and everything from gameplay to the map itself. One of the community directors at Inner Sloth, she says it would have been really, really cool to collab. Everything from game mechanics are fine, and they shouldn't be gatekept, but at the very least, even different themes or terminologies can make things more interesting. And what she means is that really they did nothing else besides just copy everything that Among Us is known for.
And Gary Porter, a developer for Among Us, also made a joke. He says, it's okay though, they flipped electrical and med bay and connected security to the cafeteria. I mean, it's just very sad and upsetting. I mean, they're willing to collaborate with Epic Games and Fortnite, and it would have been a very, like, again, an epic sort of collaboration as well. It would have been amazing. I mean, Epic Games has collaborated with many, many people before. They've collaborated with Marvel. They've collaborated all over the place.
Which makes this feel so backwards.
Exactly, you know? So backwards and so, so upsetting. I mean, they didn't patent the Among Us mechanics, is what they're saying. And they don't think this leads to a healthy game industry. And it really hard to put 10% more effort into putting your own spin-off, though. Like, they could have just added a little bit more, not to make it too obvious, but Epic Games made it. It was just so blatant. If I were Inner Sloth, if they could, they should have somehow, or they should sue them, because this is way too much. Like, it's too close.
Interestingly enough, one of the head people from Inner Sloth, they said, actually co-founder of Inner Sloth, Marcus Bromander, he says that they never patented the Among Us mechanics because he says, I don't think that leads to a healthy game industry. Mm-hmm. So it's, they're not,
I know,
really,
but even if it's not patented, they can still somehow, I mean, sue them, because this is just blatant, just copy pasting.
If anything, Epic Games should step up and give recognition, and maybe even promise for some future collaborations, because it's almost hypocritical when Epic Games is, you know, with their recent lawsuit with Apple, where they're like, oh, we're fighting for small developers.
Ironic.
But they're also undermining others, like Inner Sloth Studios.
And it's not the first time that Epic Games has done something similar. They've been stealing dances. Do you remember the Carlton dance, etc.? Mm-hmm. And we thought they learned their lessons, but apparently they did not. So shame on Epic Games, even though yesterday we're saying that it was very interesting of them. That's smart of them. But at the same time, it's not a good thing to do at all. We do not condone stealing right here on the Afternoon Karak.
The best way to boycott is just don't play the game mode.
You know. It's going to be very hard, especially for kids who don't really care about it, or people who are like, ah, oh, fair game, they just
don't get the politics.
Exactly. So I don't think that's going to happen. This is not going to affect Epic Games that much at all. But we're going to be taking a short break. We've got the Aisha and Mikhail Suggest coming up next right here on the Afternoon Karak.
It's almost 5 p.m.
That was Afternoon Karak. For dessert,
Aisha and Mikhail Suggest.
No better feeling in the world when you know you're just clocking in for those last couple of minutes as we wrap up the show. If you guys missed out on any of our discussions, our reviews, our banter, our goofs and gaffs, and all sorts of laughs, be sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel. We'll have all of our shows uploaded episodically on Pulse 95 Radio. Pulse 95 Radio, please subscribe, comment, like, share, all that good stuff. And if you enjoy podcast alternatives, well, we're also available on Spotify, SoundCloud, Apple Podcasts, and Rami. I have this memorized at this point. Type in Afternoon Karak and enjoy. But let's wrap everything up. Let's do a little finale. And we always like to give you guys a final suggestion courtesy of Aisha Mazmi.
Thank you. Thank you for that lovely introduction.
I just want to bounce.
I know that. So I'm going to make it very quick and very brief, even though I enjoy talking to you guys. But as well as it being Potato Day. It is also World Humanitarian Day.
Okay.
So it's by United Nations, and it's obviously a very important day to mark. So in accordance with such a big day, the best way to celebrate it is to be a human and try to donate. Try to donate, whether it's your time, donate some clothes, donate some food, donate some money. It's very easy to do. There are a lot of verified charities here in Sharjah. Again, go to verified charities in Sharjah or across the UAE. Go up to them, whether it is physically at the charity's actual headquarters, or you can check out the small branches they have or the kiosks they have across the entire UAE. Give them some money, or even you can go check out their websites, and there are plenty of them. For example, there is felonfund.ae. It can help some prisoners and people who have not been able to collect some debts here in the UAE. And it's just, again, it's a very important day to mark. Just a small thing will take, it will be such a big thing for other people. And with that, we wrap up the hour because Mikhail needs to bounce, quote unquote.
I got a few board games I want to play.
He wants to play some board games. And with that, we leave the desk and leave the airwaves for Yalla Home, Big Hassan, Anas Cofield. Take over from 5 p.m. all the way to 8 p.m. only here on Pulse 95.
If you liked this episode of Afternoon Karak, drop a like and subscribe. Be sure to follow us on Instagram for all our daily updates and top stories.